Welcome to Connie Martinson Talks Books. I have a book if you are interested in writing or you have written. This is a book that will make you go back, look, and decide, yes, I can make that character have three dimensions. The book is called The Master of Drama, Shakespear for Screenwriters, and it's written by my guest, J.M. Evenson. Welcome, Jenny.
Thank you.
And I should say you were also a professor at Pepperdine University in Shakespeare and creative writing.
Yes.
And I hope you're using your own book because it covers both Shakespeare and what the writer who wants to write a successful screenplay needs to know.
Absolutely.
You talk in terms of love, family, power, and war. And that's all the subjects you need to know, in a sense. But in every chapter, as you go discussing each of the plays, you talk in terms of the end of three exercises to do and films to watch.
Absolutely. I wanted to structure the book that way so that we could go through and you could go through one of the plays, you could think about some of the lessons that you could learn, and then you could try them out in your own writing, because none of this is useful if you aren't going to try it in your own writing.
Yeah. And let's begin with, as you do, Hamlet.
Right.
Now, Hamlet is to be or not to be. He's a young man in turmoil and in question. His father has died. He knows his father was killed by his mother's husband. And then his father comes back as a ghost, saying, revenge me.
Right.
And that's where he can't make the decision.
Absolutely. You know, every time I teach that play, when I teach it, I'm always astonished by how quickly the students get wrapped up in Hamlet's problems and how they just completely unspool as Hamlet's mind comes undone in the middle of the book, in the play. It's a wonderful play.
And let me say, the key points to remember here, watching characters struggle with inner conflict generate empathy for the character and create psychological complexity. And the movies to watch are On the Waterfront, Rebel Without a Cause, Good Will Hunting. Now, Jimmy Dean was a perfect Hamlet.
Yes, he was.
Yeah.
Yeah, absolutely. I really wanted to show how we can use some of the lessons that Shakespeare teaches us in movies today. And So I looked to some of the classics, like Rebel Without a Cause, to show us how there are obviously, Jimmy Dean isn't exclusively a Hamlet character, but there are elements of Shakespeare in what we're doing in film today. And what we want to do is pull on those threads and see what we can use, right?
Yeah.
And we can see which ones. Well, this one from Jimmy Dean, this is amazing. This is one of those classic moments, that moment where you're screaming, you're tearing me apart. It's very much like that eruption of emotion that happens with the two be or not to be speech. Hamlet is literally almost tearing his soul apart.
And also the conflict or the competition of a way controlling Laertes, who can move without even a question. Kill him.
Right.
Even then, Hamlet is still at the end wondering until he is killed.
I know. Well, and I think the point that I make there is that, many screenwriting manuals will tell you that you need to have your characters be on point, and they need to have a single motive, and they need to go with that, and they need to do that. But I think what Shakespeare shows us is that some of those characters, like Laertes, are a little bit flat sometimes, and that Hamlet, where he struggles and grows and changes, and we just watch him and we feel it, that actually can be an incredibly compelling character. So I think we need to think about that as an alternative view of building characters.
Well, that's, as you point out, really throughout this book, that it isn't just the direct action, it's what's going underneath.
Absolutely.
What came before? What are the conflicts?
Absolutely. I mean, we can build that into our characters. We can offer that, right? And that's what Shakespeare did with every single one of his characters. I mean, I think that's what the magic of Shakespeare is that he offered us so many characters in so many different plays that have so much going on inside of them that it's taken us 500 years. We're still not to the bottom of what's ailing Hamlet, right? We're still thinking about it. We're still drawn in like a puzzle, right?
And every time you see it, I mean, let's face it, Shakespeare would have been the best Freudian psychiatrist anyone could find. Romeo and Juliet, and you say, Shakespeare tells us what it's about and then lets us find it for ourselves.
Right, right. I think this is one of the things that's true among screenwriters is that we get very nervous that we're going to tip our hand, right, too early to the audience and they're going to figure everything out. And I think what's true is that, you know, Shakespeare tells you everything that's going to happen in Romeo and Juliet and that's the end, right? Yeah. And then except...
How does it happen?
Exactly. How does it happen? And it's full of twists and turns. The ending is a complex machinery, right? The Romeo and Juliet's ending is a complex machinery of just sort of twists, turns, and terrors, right? Yeah. And I think you can add twists and turns and still tell people what's going to happen, which is why I thought, well, perhaps I ought to compare it to The Shining, which is not, I understand, the first thing one thinks of when one thinks of Romeo and Juliet, but we tend to believe that we, you know, thrillers have to be surprising. Mm-hmm. But what Hitchcock teaches us, as well as Shakespeare, is that the bomb under the table is really what compels us as viewers.
And also the audience's empathy.
Absolutely.
Because here are two beautiful young people who could have maybe had a couple of years together, but because the Capulets are fighting with the...
Right.
And they are... It'll never be. But they do get a moment together.
They do.
You pull out that speech about it's not the nightingale.
Right.
Yeah.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, I think in one of the chapters I think about why is this the most romantic story ever told? I mean, we think of it that way. Almost everyone believes that. But, you know, we really haven't thought about why we think it's so romantic. But there are a few things about that play that really build in its romance. And one of them is that we get that sort of moment of paradise. And it's just a golden, beautiful moment. And we all have had that moment in our love. I mean, I hope you have.
Yes, go on.
Right. Yeah. So that we've had that moment. And we just, it's something that we think of as some one of the most beautiful things you can experience in life is that moment. And Shakespeare offers that to us, and we need to offer that to our viewers when we create a film, right?
Right, and when you, as the audience, want to shake her and say, don't do it now.
I know.
Don't do it now, because we know the ending, but we know they have become so real to us we can speak to them on stage.
Well, that's, I think, the other magic of that play is just that I don't know how many times I've read it, maybe 50, 60 times, and every time I just think to myself, no, don't drink the poison, no, just wake up. You know, it's just, there. You get so wrapped up in it, even despite the fact that it seems, the ending seems so inevitable, we're never, ever, ever lulled into feeling nothing. We always feel something, and that's because his characters are so rich, and he figures out how to construct that story, so just pulls us in.
That concept of telling and knowing the ending, as we've talked, it seems to me that this is what Jane Eyre, the Bronte sisters, knew, Wuthering Heights, how to put it into a drama, or at least into written book.
Right. Oh, absolutely. I mean, this is, you know, certainly we think of Shakespeare as the greatest writer of all time, but there have been many, many others who know how to wrap us up and use, you know, and Jane Eyre, of course, is one of those. I mean, it's just a wonderful story.
Yeah. Macbeth, now, is he the villain or is Lady Macbeth? Why didn't Shakespeare call it Lady Macbeth?
That is a great question. I don't know. I don't know. But I think that she's one of my favorite characters. And honestly, many people ask me what my favorite Shakespeare play is, and sometimes I tease them by saying it's Timon of Athens, but it's actually not. It's Macbeth, really. I love Macbeth, and I think it's because of Lady Macbeth. I mean, she is an audacious character who is completely obsessed with achieving her goal, right?
Yeah.
Which is to become the Queen of Scotland. And it's a, she's just burns with this kind of passionate energy.
Now, for this one, there are the key points to remember. There are movies to watch, Scarface, Misery, and There Will Be Blood.
Right.
But the exercises are very important. And this is where I think you've created, for the person who reads this, the aha moment.
Right.
Because it's, everybody has been obsessed with something at some point in their lives. Name one thing you were obsessed with, and what did you do? A list of the top 10 most shockingly audacious things you did or wished you did to get it. Then it's create an obsessed character. And third, imagine an opening scene for your hypothetical character that crackles with observed energy, obsessive energy. And what is your character doing? And these are the sort of questions as you go past and look at a, something you've written, is, wait a minute, I could have done this there.
Right. I mean, I think what's true is that, you know, Shakespeare absolutely touches on timeless human experiences that we've all had. We've all been obsessed with something.
Yeah.
And there were a few things I wished I'd done that were more shocking, some less shocking, you know.
All right. Well, I won't ask you that.
No, but yeah. It's true. I mean, the thing about Shakespeare is the humanity of it. And So then look to your own experiences. Yeah. Draw out what's human about you, right? Yeah. And put that into your characters. That's what Shakespeare did. I think we can all do that as writers.
And then there's Othello and a man named Iago.
Oh, yes.
Because there is Othello married to Desdemona. He adores her. She adores him. Their marriage has now been approved. And then Iago puts that bug in his ear. Do you know if she's been faithful?
Right.
And it goes from there. And yet you say that he is the mystery villain of Shakespeare.
He's the mystery villain. Oh, yes.
Why?
Iago.
What is he? Yeah.
Well, Iago is a strange bird because he doesn't have a motive. Or more specifically, he has so many motives that at the end you think, which one was right? Is he lying about all of them? Does he have no motive at all? If you give us too many reasons, then suddenly we realize you don't have a reason.
Yeah.
Right? So there's Coleridge called him a villain of motiveless malignity. And I personally think that's about the most frightening sort of villain there is one that you can't predict, you can't understand, you can't reason with him. There are no rules that you can follow to save yourself. There's nothing there, right?
Yeah.
And it was someone who loves you. That's terrifying to think of someone who's close to you. I mean, I think that is the real... I think Shakespeare had his finger on real terror there. It's not, you know, this torture porn of ripping off toenails and whatnot. It really is about someone who loves you doing something that you can't understand and you can't even see coming. I mean, I think that's much more horrifying.
Yeah. Now, for this, key points to remember... And then movies to watch, and among them is Titanic, Life is Beautiful, and The Curious Case of Benjamin Button.
Right.
Yeah.
Yeah, those are, you know, I actually thought Titanic worked for a number of different ones, but I really do think that when you're looking at tragedies, and what Shakespeare knew about tragedy was that it's irrelevant if it's big or, you know, if you've got big consequences. And I think as writers, we're always grasping for the whole world is at stake. But really, at the end of the day, what makes people feel is if they know the characters and they care about them and they're watching them suffer. And Shakespeare knew that. And that's how his, you know, tragedies where Othello is just about this two people, really. It's not about anything big. It's just about these two people. And yet we remember it as a towering tragedy.
Yeah.
Right? And we feel it.
And there's the racist part because Othello was a black Moor.
Yes.
And even, you know, the whole thing of Othello is pertinent to anybody who's writing a screenplay for today.
I would absolutely agree with that. I mean, I really do think that just about everything Shakespeare did would be relevant, really, for what's going on today, because he was interested in these timeless lessons, so we can learn things from him.
King Lear is the other you start with watching him and the cruelty in the man to his daughters and the stupidity, who loves me the most, and how he finally, the degradation, step by step, till he's on the moors with the fool. And it is only Cordelia who will be there for him. Even then, she's dead.
I love King Lear. That's a very special play. It's unusually shaped. It's structured like an avalanche. So it starts at the high point, and then it just cascades into this abyss of sadness.
Interestingly enough, at the end, you talk about Shakespeare getting inspiration from, well, I knew about Hamlet from Denmark, from a story there, but I didn't know about the rich man who had that with his three daughters.
You know, what's interesting is that, many of these plays, actually King Lear's not the only one, but many of the plays that Shakespeare wrote make reference to current events, but they aren't so current to us anymore. So I was a Renaissance scholar, so of course I knew many of the current events, including, say, Taming of the Shrew is another one that was surrounded by many sort of current events that were happening at the time. But it's interesting when you go back and look at it how much Shakespeare drew inspiration from things like history or the news. Places where you can find strange and sordid stories even today.
Right.
You know, I would say.
Just think of all the plays that are going to come out of the Madoff scandal.
I would see, right?
Yeah.
That's a tragedy right there.
Right. Because either you were one of those taken or you knew somebody who was, and what the final result was.
Yeah, you know, and I personally pitched a bunch of stories, actually, around town. I mean, it's one of those common things. You're given a news article and asked to figure out how to pitch this as a story. And it's actually very common around in Hollywood. So, and it's something that Shakespeare did as well. So that hasn't changed. We also haven't stopped making remakes, which is what Shakespeare was doing, really.
Crown and Shield, right. Wasn't that it for the history of the royalty in England?
Yes, and Holinshed Chronicles were very popular. So he actually wrote most of his plays. The bulk of his plays were history plays.
Yeah.
And so there's lots of, lots of history movies that are coming out now, and they tend to make a lot of money. People really like to go that,
well,
right?
Because
Titanic, one of the highest grossing films of all time, Gladiator, these are 300. These are amazing films. It's sort of history, right? 300
is based on
history.
That's the point. They feel they're learning something, but they're also enjoying.
Yeah, I think there's that. I think it's also true that historical figures are sort of like the celebrities of the past, you know? And we want to know about them. We want to know the nitty-gritty details of their personal lives. Also, in truth, we usually go to historical figures that made a difference, right? Like Spartacus he made a difference, right? He was he's an inspiring figure. So.
And, of course, there's Henry the Fifth, and who will be here at St. Crippen's Day.
Right. Yeah. Henry V, of course, the French don't think he's so wonderful, but...
That's their problem. On the other hand, there's Richard III, and there is Queen Anne coming, set down thy honorable coffin, in essence, if honor can be in a box.
Right.
Yeah.
I know, yeah. Richard III is a fascinating, fascinating character. He's one of my very favorite villains. Just because of his incredible intellectual prowess. Shakespeare doesn't write anyone else like Richard III, who is, I think, probably closest to somebody like Hannibal Lecter today, where he just, the incredible knowledge and sense of mastery over everyone he meets is intoxicating for the viewers.
Yeah,
it really
is. It's a manipulator.
It is. It's a master manipulator. Yeah. We want to see that, and I personally find that both terrifying and fascinating.
How you have written that chapter, though, is so great because, you know, when you're watching the play, at times you're carried so away you don't really hear the words. And hearing the words here, it suddenly said, oh, yes. And he's saying to her, look, you can kill me or kiss me. I mean, there was no in-between for Richard III.
I know. I mean, he actually does... He does get her to this place where he offers her this incredible logical fallacy of, you know, I killed your husband because I was in love with you, and certainly, you know, you can either fall in love with me or kill me. And I think the other, I mean, there's probably a third option there, which is just to walk away and give him a finger. I don't know. I think. But that isn't how she responds. And so he has her trapped in this sort of intellectual prison, you know, prison, and she gets sucked into it, and it's fascinating to watch him work, the little machinations of Richard moving everywhere around him, and then to see it come apart at the end is also fascinating.
Interesting, too, as we have come through the Egyptian spring, is reading Julius Caesar.
Oh, yes.
Because here you have the man who his opponents included some he considered his friends. And power corrupts, total power corrupts totally.
Yes, yes. You know, actually, when I was doing my PhD, I did it actually on Orientalism and about the East and how that's conceived. And I think that part of what's going on with Julius Caesar is this very, very interesting representation of Egypt as this exotic, you know, wonderful, you know, place, and it's represented by feminine beauty and all these other things, but wild and sexual and untamed and all these other things. And I think that we still that sense of the East persists, I would say, in modern political takes on the East.
Yeah, and the interesting too is how Mark Antony goes from being the hero at Caesar's death and his giving the testimonial at his funeral, then becomes sort of the playboy of the Western world with Cleopatra.
It is interesting. I mean, I think there are... Shakespeare took each play as it came, but for that one play, he used Mark Antony as this fantastic hero, and then later showed how he deteriorated. And I think part of what he was trying to show was a character who is sucked into and destroyed by their setting, right? And we've seen this happen over and over again. Apocalypse Now is what I refer to in the book, because we're watching a character be sucked into and destroyed by the setting. It's very much like A Heart of Darkness. We've seen this before. There's fish out of water stories, and then there's people who go native, and then that going native can create madness for the character. And that's really what he's showing us with Mark Antony, that his love for Cleopatra, he gets sucked into this beautiful, luscious, exotic setting, and then he's destroyed by that. But that is a character pattern.
Yeah. And part of Shakespeare's characters changing.
Absolutely. So he shows us that. So Shakespeare wasn't afraid to let his characters move and be different, and make it so that they were hard to pin down.
Well, if people want to know the rest of what you have to say here about villains, heroes, Much Ado About Nothing, and The Winter's Tale, which, again, I hadn't known that much about. It's just, for such a small book, it is so superb, Jenny. And it's published by Michael Wiese, he's making film as almost a college course away from colleges.
It's amazing. I mean, the whole group of books are just amazing, so that you can actually learn so much about making a film from these books, which is...
How did you happen to tie in that you would write this book?
Well, I actually have a PhD in Renaissance literature and an MFA in creative writing, so I just put them together because someone actually asked me if I was going to do a Shakespeare play on film, and I thought, Shakespeare, why would I? And then I thought, wait, that's a good idea. Wait, why am I not interested in Shakespeare? So I sent in the proposal at 11 p.m. at night, and by 10 a.m. the next morning, I was actually giving an exam in my class at Pepperdine.
Yeah.
And I had something like 3 emails and 2 voicemails from Michael Wiese. So that was nice.
Nice. Yeah. Anybody who writes something, so you jump.
Right. You think that's nice. Yeah. So I knew and that vote of confidence made me feel like I could write the book, and then I did.
You did. And we only just covered maybe a third of it. That's right. How wonderful this book is. Jenny, will you sign my book for me?
I will.
Thank you. And if you'd like to know what else we've been reading, visit me on the web, www.ConnieMartinson, or go to YouTube to Connie Martinson's channel and support your local library. Go in. Take out a card. Take a child with you. There are some terrific Shakespeare for children, and it's a great way to sort of introduce them to the plays or the stories that Shakespeare wrote. Then, of course, it doesn't hurt if you take them to theater or even get some DVDs of Shakespeare, of films that have been made. So support your library. Help your child learn to read and to read better, and we'll see you next time. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
And truly, for